Good. Yes. Well, I want to thank everyone watching this live. We're glad to have you with us for the free enterprise. And well, we have a great man who is about to join us. Many of you probably recognize him for his legendary 999 tax plan. Herman Cain is an author, a radio talk show host, a business executive, and a fierce conservative warrior. He has spoken for Young America's Foundation on numerous college campuses and at previous conferences. If any of you would be interested in having Herman Cain come to your college, please contact the app right away. Herman grew up in a hardworking family in Atlanta, Georgia. His parents had two dreams: to own their own home and for their kids to graduate college. In order to make this come true, Herman's father worked three jobs as a janitor, a barber, and a chauffeur, while his mom did domestic work. Inspired by the work ethic of his parents, he decided to pursue a master's degree in computer science from Purdue University while working full-time developing fire control systems for ships and planes. After Herman received his master's degree, he returned to his home of Atlanta and began working his way up in the business world, specifically the food industry. He worked as a computer analyst for Coca-Cola and then went to Pillsbury. He ended up becoming the vice president, but he left soon after to work. His success at Burger King led him to accepting the biggest challenge of his career, becoming the president and CEO of Godfather's Pizza, a company that was on the edge of bankruptcy. In just 14 months, he returned to Godfather's to profitability and led his management team to a buyout of the company. His success at Godfather's garnered the respect and admiration of his industry peers, who named him the president of the National Restaurant Association. Today, if you live in Atlanta, you can hear Herman on the radio where he hosts the Herman Cain Show. And he just told me he was number one. How about that? Herman is also a regular contributor on multiple news stations and has been a keynote speaker at many conferences nationwide. Please give it up for Herman Cain.
Yeah. I love it, love it, love it. Thanks, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. What a nice reception. Thank you. Wow. I am delighted and thrilled to be here. I like that part where he said, fierce conservative. You got to be fierce in the environment if you want to maintain your conservative values. I'm delighted and thrilled to be here. I have spoken at a lot of colleges and universities over the past couple of years. How many of you all were at colleges or universities that I've spoken to the last couple of years that are here? Wow, okay. Raise your hands high again. Very good. So you remember when I was there before, and I've also spoken at this very distinguished conference. As you can tell by the people that they have been able to get to come and share their thoughts with you. So I am thrilled to be here. And I want to thank the people from YAF for inviting me and giving me this opportunity. I did my radio show this morning live from the Heritage Foundation. Whenever I'm in DC, I can do my radio show remote from a station here, and I usually use Heritage because it is a bastion of conservative thought, as you know. And I mentioned to my audience today that I was going to be speaking to this group today. So I gave y'all a little publicity to 5 million people, 5 million of my closest friends. You'll probably need a bigger room next year because a lot of people said they have a conservative student conference going on. Yeah. And I indicated to them what I was going to share with you today. And it's about the American dream. The American dream. I have some good news and some bad news about the American dream. First, the good news. The American dream is alive and well. It is alive and well.
You have a lot of people who want you to think that it's not. You have a lot of people who want you to think that you have to be dependent upon government. You have a lot of people who think that the American dream is a fleeting fantasy. You see, when the founding fathers conceived the Declaration of Independence, which provided the foundation for the Constitution of the United States of America, the greatness of the Declaration and the Constitution is that the founding fathers wrote the Declaration of Independence not based upon where this nation was at its founding, but where they envisioned this nation being in the future. When they said, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men, inclusive women, all men are created equal and that they are endowed by their creator, not somebody else's, not the government's, but whoever you view as your creator, endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." Fundamental, basic. But you've got some people that are trying to turn life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness into a list of suggestions. Those aren't suggestions. Those are pillars of what we call the American dream. I had a caller to my radio show one night when I was doing a nighttime show. He calls up and said, "Mr. Cain, I'm frustrated. I don't like the way things are going in this country, and I don't know what to do." I said, "Well, I have one suggestion for you." He said, "What's that?" I said, "Well, why don't you go and get a copy of the Declaration of Independence? Do you have one?" He said, "Yes." Went and got his copy of the Declaration of Independence, came back, still on the air. Heard him flipping through the pages. I said, "Find that part about life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." He said, "I found it." I said, "Now here's what you can do if you are frustrated about doing something to help protect the American dream." He said, "What's that, Mr. Cain?" I said, "When you get the life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, keep reading. Don't stop there. Because it says that when any form of government becomes destructive of those ideals, it is the right of the people to alter or abolish it." You have a right to alter or abolish things that you don't like. It's not only a right, it's a responsibility. And I'm going to drive the media people crazy moving around so much. They're used to people just being stationary, but I have too much passion about this country and too much passion about the American dream to stand still when I'm talking about it. You have the right and the responsibility to alter or abolish things that you don't like, that we the people do not like. So it's alive and well. That's the good news. In my introduction, he mentioned my parents. They pursued their American dream. But you see, their dream was a little different than mine. Just like your parents' dream, it's probably a little different than yours. My dad's dream was real simple. He wanted to be able to own what we call the whole house. We grew up in a half a house. In some parts of the country, they call it a duplex. Three rooms on one side, three rooms on the other side, with a wall going down the middle. My brother and I used to ask Dad all the time, "Dad, why do we live in a half a house?" Dad used to say, "It's a duplex." "But Dad, we only live in half of it." "It's a duplex." Because when Dad was working those three jobs, we didn't know that he was working one job to keep a roof over our head, second job to put food on the table, and that third job to save for his American dream. Not his brothers and his sisters. He grew up with eight brothers and sisters on a little small dirt farm in Tennessee. He was the only one who walked off of the farm. It wasn't their dream. He and my mother ended up in Atlanta, Georgia, where we were raised. Because Dad wanted to have a whole house instead of a half a house. That was his dream. And I'll never forget the day when Dad came home on a Saturday. Man working three jobs usually doesn't have any time off. He came home on a Saturday. He told my mother, my brother, and I, my brother was a year and a half younger than me, get in the car. We got in the car. We didn't know what was up. We thought we was going to get ice cream. About 35 minutes later, Dad pulled up on a little street called Albert Street, stopped at the third house on the right-hand side, and announced to my mother, my brother, and I was headed to the eighth grade. My brother was sixth grade. He said, "This is our new home." We were in shock. We did not know that Dad had saved enough money to buy that whole house, brand new. My mother didn't even know that Dad had saved enough money to buy that whole house. She didn't even know that he had gone out and bought the house. Now, young men, don't try that in your life. It won't work today. You marry somebody and buy a house and she doesn't know about it? Man, when you get the hands on the hips and the neck moving, you's in a heap of trouble. What do you mean you bought me a house? No, 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 no. Consult with her. But Dad could get away with it because my mom never dreamed of living in a brand new house that she could make our home. That was his American dream. One of them. And he knew that in order to achieve his American dream, that he had to use the only kind of equity he had when he walked off that farm. Sweat equity. Sweat equity. His other dream was for his sons to get a little bit better start in life than he did. That's why he wanted us to go to college. We did. We were the first in our families on both sides to graduate from college. Thank you. Because that was one of the things that they wanted, was for us to get a little bit better start in life. And so that's why I'm so passionate about the American dream. People listen to my radio show. I have to sometimes calm myself down and remind them that I'm not angry. I'm just passionate about this because I get upset when I see the American dream attacked. The good news is the American dream is alive and well. The bad news is it's under attack by what I call the Asians. I didn't say Asians. A-T-I-O-N-S, Asians, too much legislation, too much regulation, and too much taxation. It's under attack. Too much legislation. Why do we need a law to mandate to a private company to pay for abortive contraception for women? I recognize it's every woman's right, but you shouldn't make a company pay for it. That's not right. We got laws for stuff that we don't need laws for. This morning when I was headed over to the studio, the driver's name, his name is Ben. And we got to talking. I said, "Ben," I said, "you live in the district?" He said, "Yes." I said, "Okay. How long you been here?" "Oh, I've been here a long time." He said, "but starting Friday is going to be slow week for us. I said, oh, you mean slow time? He said slow time because Congress is out of session for 5 weeks. He said, so it's going to be our slow time. I said, well, outside of D.C., the rest of the country is applauding and celebrating that they went home. He said, why? They can't hurt us if they are not here in Washington, D.C. Go home sometimes. They're not passing any bad laws if they are at home. Go home. I wish they'd stay for a couple of years. I don't think we'd miss a beat. Too much legislation. Too much regulation. Got everything regulated from A to Z. The push continues to try to regulate. You heard about the war on coal? Some of you heard about it. The EPA on steroids is arbitrarily setting some goals for coal companies to hit, not based on science. They just pulled it out of the air or some part of their anatomy. Use your imagination. Use your imagination. Because they just thought it was a good idea. If you were to shut down every coal company, coal-fired energy company in this country, it's not going to impact the world's pollution situation. I'm not saying that we should not care about the earth. I'm not saying that we should not care about the planet. I'm not saying we should not care about the environment. But I think we should put that in the proper priority. And to me, the first priority ought to be making sure you don't destroy businesses, destroy jobs, and destroy people's lives for something that isn't a priority. And I was giving a speech in outside of Buffalo, New York last week, and the audience was pretty receptive. And as soon as I got to climate change, man, a fist fight almost broke up. I said, climate change is not a crisis. One third of the room said, yes, it is. Another third of the room said, no, it's not. I said, whoa. Y'all call me when y'all get through fighting. People are very emotional about it. Look at the facts. Look at the science. The science is not settled. It is not. Unfortunately, we have a lot of people in this country who do not do their own research. So if somebody tells them over and over and over and over and over and over that it is a settled science, they believe it. That's why on the radio, 5 days a week, 3 hours a day, I tell people over and over and over and over and over and over, no, it's not. I got to counterbalance some of that stuff. There's a whole. If they were based upon science and analysis, that's one thing. But the reason that the American dream is under attack is because many of the regulations are not based upon science and fact. And as a result, a lot of businesses are struggling just to survive. American dream is under attack. By the way, I'm going to do Q&A, so if you think some questions, we're going to do Q&A, as you know. I love that part. But if it's based upon fact and science, that's one thing. American dream is under attack by too much legislation, too much regulation, too much taxation. We still have the highest corporate tax rate of most countries in the world. I think they found another one recently that was maybe higher than the United States. Small country. It's been that way for decades. And one of the biggest lies coming from the lips of any politician of either party. They told me to keep this nonpartisan. Trying to do that, Kyle. One of the biggest lies that I hope you will remember if you hear a politician say, we need tax reform. No. We need tax code replacement, not reform. If we don't replace this sick, perverted tax code, you're going to have a hard time achieving your American dream. And I've got grandkids almost your age. So what I remind audiences of, whether I'm on the radio or whether I'm speaking, I'm not out here speaking for me and my wife of 46 years. Yep. It's for the children and the grandchildren. Just like my dad wanted us to be able to achieve our American dreams, I want you and my children and everybody's grandchildren to be able to achieve their American dream. That's what this is about. That's what this is about. That's why I was thrilled to be invited here to challenge you, to be a part of the solution and not a part of the problem. You're familiar with many of the problems. One of the biggest problems, quite simply, is apathy on the part of too many people. They're busy with their lives. They're busy trying to make it. They're busy trying to send their kids to school. They're busy watching American Idol. There's nothing wrong with watching American Idol. But read a book every once in a while. You know, that won't kill you. Go to an informative, inspiring website occasionally, such as HermanCain.com. Check it out. Y'all got iPads and iPhones and I this and I that. You can hear my radio show 24/7. Did you all know that? All you got to do is go to my website. We have a link called Cain 24/7, 24 hours a day. Because what happens is when the show finishes at noon, they loop it every 3 hours. So you can't get away from me if you don't want to. But check the show out. If you were to go to my website right now and click on it, you'd hear the show that I did this morning. Technology is a beautiful thing when it works. When it works. We got to replace the tax code. You can't reform it. It's too complicated. It's too messed up. And it is used as a tool by politicians of both parties to manipulate the public and to control our money. So here's what we need to do to be a part of the solution. Three things. Stay informed. Because if you don't know what's going on, if you don't know when you're being lied to, you will be played, as we used to say, in the hood. Or as some people say in different circles, you will be made a fool of. You'll be played if you don't know the facts. Stay informed. Stay informed. An advantage that you have that I didn't have when I was in college is the internet. But not everything on the internet you can believe. Half of it is garbage. Figure out which part is accurate, which part you can trust. Find your list of sites that you go to on a regular basis so you can be in the know as to what's going on. The opening tagline for my radio show every day, and I say it every day live, we don't even play it recorded. When you listen to the Herman Cain show, we're going to tell you the truth. We're going to give you the facts because we want you to be informed about what's going on. And if you don't know the facts, you can be lied to. If you don't know the facts, you might vote for the wrong person. So stay informed. And I'm dead serious. Check out HermanCain.com. I have some of the best writers on the planet And every day we put up what we call news nuggets in audio form. They're usually about 2 minutes in length. Certain nuggets from the radio show where you can listen to what I may have talked about that day. I was telling my executive producer, Shane, this morning, I said, you know, if we knew what the show was going to be about every day, it would probably scare the crap out of us. Because we do the show starting out with an idea of what we want to talk about. But then, based upon the calls and the subjects that come up, or if we get breaking news, we'll change on the fly. We'll change on the fly. For example, we're in the middle of doing the show, and so Shane, he can send to me on my iPad. Not only do I see all of the callers, and I can select the callers myself remotely on my iPad, but he's got a teleprompter capability where if there's a breaking news announcement, he can put that up in front of me and I can do breaking news and he'll play a little sounder. And this morning, he put one up and I'm going, is this true? He said, yeah. I said, okay, when we come back. Breaking news. The Democrats were gonna hold a birthday celebration for Medicare and Medicaid at 10:30 today. Because this is Medicare and Medicaid's 49th birthday. Whoop-de-doo. Now, I know a lot of people depend upon Medicare and Medicaid, but it has a lot of problems. And here's something that they didn't say at the birthday party. Remember talking about stay informed? Here's what they didn't tell people at the birthday party. They talked about all of the people that are benefiting. They talked about all of the great things about it, etc. They didn't tell people that in 1965, when Medicare first started, they spent $6 billion to roll it out. Billion. And then promised the American people that by 1990, 25 years later, it was only going to cost $12 billion. The cost would double in 25 years because of population growth. That's what the American people were told. In 1990, it didn't cost $12 billion. It wasn't $24 billion. It was $109 billion. A 900% miss. Have you ever passed a math exam missing something by 900%? No. Most people will get fired. But what do? We reelect them. They didn't tell people that. Now we're going to put on top of it, this is nonpartisan, the hijacking of the healthcare system. And we're told that it's going to save people money. Not yet. It's going to reduce people's premiums. Not yet. Know the facts. Stay informed. Because I've said before, and I may have said this on some of the campuses that I visited. And my predecessor by the name of Neil Boitz. Yeah, Boitz is a good friend. He was a predecessor. He corrected me one day when I said, stupid people are ruining America. He says, no, Herman, ignorant people are ruining America. See, you can't fix stupid, but you can fix ignorant, and that's exactly the case. If people don't know, they can be misled by false ads, negative attacks, and false information. So number one, stay informed, and you got resources to do that that previous generations didn't have. Secondly, there's only three things. Not nine. I mean, I could stretch it to nine, but I don't have that much time. Three things. Secondly, stay involved. Politics is not a spectator sport. You got to be in the game. There are a lot of different ways you can be in the game. I know you got your college education that you're focused on. That should be number one. You're trying to graduate. That's a goal that you have. That is a great goal. Don't give up on it. The last thing an employer wants to hear is, I almost got my degree. Well, that ain't good enough. And the reason is, it shows that you gave up. And companies don't like quitters. It punctuates you doing whatever you needed to do in order to finish. So I don't want anybody in here to not finish that, at least that bachelor's degree, because it'll make a statement and it'll help you down the road in ways you don't even realize. But spend a little time taking a look at people running for office in your congressional district. Whether that's back home or whether that's where you're in school, take a look at who's running for the United States Senate. Maybe you want to spend a few hours during the summer to go and work in their campaign office, to stuff envelopes, to make phone calls. A lot of ways you can stay involved. And then when you graduate and you get that good job, don't forget about what's going on around you. I know I didn't wake up until what was going on around me until I saw how the attack of the Asians was impacting a business that I ran, Godfather's Pizza. Here I'm going to Godfather's Pizza with the objective of trying to turn the company around. Pillsbury owned Godfather's, by the way, but when they appointed me president of the company, they had already decided that it was going to go bankrupt and that it couldn't be saved. But I didn't get the memo. So I didn't know we were supposed to fail. So we turned it around. See, I was like the bumblebee. The bumblebee aerodynamically is not supposed to fly. I used to be a mathematician. I studied physics in college. I don't remember any of it. But I do remember that a bumblebee is not supposed to fly. Aerodynamically, they've tried to prove with the equations of motion that the bumblebee flies, but every time they put them in the equations of motion and they measure the parameters of that little fat body and the little flappy wings, and they put them in equations of motion, and they run the computer model, and it comes back and says, the sucker can't fly. So the physicists and the mathematicians and the aerodynamicists, you didn't know I could say those words, did you? They all say, well, maybe we need to get some more measurements of these little fat bodies and the little flappy wings and put them in a bigger computer and put them in a faster computer, run the computer model, and it comes back and says, the sucker still can't fly. There's only one reason that the bumblebee can fly. It believes that it can fly. That's what. Why did I run for president of the United States? I believed that I could win and damn near did. Y'all will have to edit out damn near because my pastor wouldn't like that. Bleep that part out. Whatever your dream is, you have to believe it. It's not for somebody else to believe whatever your American dream is. Dad walked off that farm, it was his dream. The other brothers and sisters, they were too scared to leave. And as a result, they never achieved the American dreams that they could have achieved. So stay informed. Stay involved. And thirdly, stay inspired. There are people who want you to believe that the American dream is dead. No, it's not. It's alive and well. We've just got some altering and abolishing to do. We've got some changes to make. Believe in your American dream. But it begins with having a dream. And the reason you need to have a dream or dreams, plural, is because they can change. Don't get in a twitch over not knowing exactly what you are going to do or start once you get out of college. Don't get in a twitch over your major. Pick a major, learn as much as you can, and if you have to change it, you can change it, but if you don't. And the reason is because in every major, you're going to learn some things that transcend subject matter. So it's not as critical as, it's not so much as critical as to what your major is, unless you have a passion for it. That's the major that you ought to take, one that you believe in, one you're passionate about, something that you feel like you enjoy. That's how you pick your major. And then later on, your career may take a totally different course. I was a mathematics major and a physics minor in undergraduate. I got my master's in computer science from Purdue University. Anybody here from Purdue University? All right, we got a Purdue person here. I got my master's in computer science from Purdue University. I thought I was going to be a mathematician the rest of my life. Wrong. When I went to work at Coca-Cola, the skills that I had learned were applicable to some of the projects that I worked on. Then before you know it, I had been recruited by the Pillsbury Company to go to work at Pillsbury, worked my way up the computer IT ladder, eventually was appointed vice president of information technology for the Pillsbury Company. And then after doing that and reaching that level at an early age, I decided that I needed a new dream. Because becoming a vice president was one of my dreams. But once I got there, I said, nah, I'm not ready to retire on the job yet. And that's when I said, I want to be president of something for somebody somewhere doing anything. And so the president of the company then said, well, you need to go into our restaurant division. We need a lot of leaders there. So I did. I had to take a cut in pay, lost my title, lost my stock options to start all over to go pursue my new dream. Why is it important to have a dream? Because if you do not have a dream, how will you know you got there? You won't know you got there. Have you ever come across people who feel like they are just wandering in the wilderness in life? They don't know where they are. They don't know where they're going. They don't know what they want to do. Even if you don't achieve that dream, you need to have it so you'll know that you didn't get there. And you can set another dream. So stay inspired and believe in your dreams. But it needs to be your dream, whatever it is. Whatever it is. So in summary, the American dream is alive and well. It starts with your dream. But it's under attack by the Haitians. That's why you've got to stay informed. Stay involved. And stay inspired. Because Dr. Mays of Morehouse College, when I was a student there, used to remind all of the young men of Morehouse. He said, let it be borne in mind that the tragedy of life does not lie in not reaching your goals. The tragedy lies in having no goals to reach for. It's not a calamity to die with dreams unfulfilled, but it is a calamity to have no dreams. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you. Oh, wow. We got some questions. Thank you very much. I don't have a cold, folks. It's just the old allergy thing. That's all it is. Now, I got a question for Pat Coyle. Where's Pat? Pat's my man. Pat's been booking me all over the country, all these universities, and inviting me to come here. How come my picture's not up on the wall over here with all these others? What's up with that, Pat? I thought... Now I guess I know. Just kidding. Yes, sir. Joseph.
How are you doing, sir? Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
I read your book, and I thought it was really good, but...
Which one?
Forgive me. It was an audiobook from my parents, so I believe it. In the book, you talk about how your mother made you work during the summer on book reports so you could stay educated. What book has most inspired you in your life?
Other than the Bible, that's number one. Bible number one. Bible number one. A lot of them have inspired me in my life. The autobiography of Dr. Benjamin Mays is an example. He was the president of Morehouse College. He started with nothing, and, you know, he has a very impressive career and overcame obstacles. I like reading about people who have had to remove barriers all their life to get to where they were trying to get to. So Dr. Benjamin Mays' autobiography would be one of the ones that impacted my life in terms of my beliefs, in terms of my determination, motivation, and all of that. So I would say it would be Dr. Benjamin M. Mays. Now, this other gentleman, my dad obviously was a big inspiration, but he didn't write a book. He could read, but he didn't write a book. Another gentleman by the name of Mr. Charles Johnson was my high school math teacher. He inspired me. He didn't write a book either, but he was an incredible source of inspiration for me to believe in my dreams. And I'll never forget, Mr. Johnson asked me one day, I was in high school. He said, in his southern drawl, Herman, Cain, he said, you can be whatever you want to be. You just might have to work a little harder, or you might have to work a little longer. So it wasn't so much as books as it was people who inspired me individually.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Joseph. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Juliana Alvey. I'm from Kansas City, Kansas. And I work with inner city kids during the summer in a literacy program. And one of the problems I find is that these kids don't have role models. They don't have, like you said, with your father and your teacher, their school system has lost accreditation, so they don't have these role models in their lives to look to. What would be advice you would give to these children who have, come from very low economic standpoints and come from very hard situations? How would you perhaps
change their paradigm?
Yes, exactly.
Do you have a laptop computer?
Yes.
Can you take it with you when you go to work with them? All right. Start finding one at a time bios of people who came from hard times or came from situations like that. And then periodically, when the timing is right, show it to a group of kids. So let me tell you about Dr. Ben Carson, okay? And then show them about a 4 or 5 minute video or something that'll be entertaining. And, well, let me tell you about this guy, Herman Cain. Let me tell you about Alan West. Let me tell you about, you see what I mean? Just little vignettes, because kids don't want to be overpowered with too much stuff all at one time. So put together, or maybe someone has already put together a series of vignettes. So the first place I would look and see if somebody's already put together some vignettes on very famous Americans. Now, I know that in the inner city, those kids are going to want to see people that look like them. But there are a lot of conservative, successful people out there. Did you know that the guy who is the president of American Express is a black guy? No. Some people knew that, but a lot of people don't even know that. I mean, that would be another one. So you have to put together a compilation of those and just periodically, informally, let me show you something. That's how I would go about doing it.
Thank you.
To help change their paradigm. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Mr. Cain. Super exciting to get to talk to you.
Thank you.
My name is Catherine Nichols, and I go to Clemson University. And I think that you are one of the coolest guys out there. In fact, one time I skipped school so that I could see you on tour with Stephen Colbert at College Charleston.
Right.
So I really like you. But as far as how cool you are, I think that personally, the conservative movement is kind of losing their coolness.
Yeah.
And I was going to ask what your opinion is on how we could gain that back as we go into 2016 so that we can really work on winning the young, uninformed voter over the way that Obama did in his elections.
Yes. Great point. the Republican Party has lost its cool and its swagger, to be perfectly honest with you. Here's what we need to do to get it back. One, we need to do a better job of articulating what these conservative principles are. Conservatism is real simple. Less government, less taxes, more individual responsibility, and adhere to the Constitution. That's all conservatism it is. All of these other things around it are just offshoots of those four fundamental things. I've had on multiple occasions somebody call my radio show, and when I define conservatism like that, I had a lady call me one night who was in tears. She and her mom were in tears. Said, "Mr. Cain, I'm sitting here with my mom crying." I said, "Why?" She said, "Because all these years we thought we were liberal, and we just, based upon your definition, found out we were conservative." Republicans don't do a good job of articulating that in the right way. That's number one. Excuse me. So I've been all over ranks previous, chairman of the Republican National Committee, to work on better articulating what those principles are in ways that people can understand. Not in political speak, not in Republican speak. No, you got to talk in terms that connects with people and what it means to them. So that's the first thing, clear articulation of the message. Now, if they don't do it, I'm going to do it. And then I'm going to put it on HermanCain.com so you can get it and you can use it. But seriously, it starts with that. Secondly, we know that the mainstream media is not our friends as conservatives. Most of us realize that. And so that's where networking, the internet, finding people that you want to follow. A lot of people follow me on Facebook and this sort of thing, and there are people that I follow because I know that we have a connection there. So it starts with clearly articulating the message, and then when those opportunities arise where you can talk to someone to help them learn something, you'll be better equipped. It gets back to stay informed, but it starts with we got to do a better job of articulating the message of conservatism. Thank you. Yes, ma'am. Purdue University.
Yes.
See,
spoiler up. My name's Alex Gandelmeyer, and from Purdue. And in high school, I had an American history teacher that totally demonized the American dream.
Yeah.
He said it was materialistic and selfish. How, as conservatives, do we convey to our liberal peers that the American dream is something to be pursued and embraced rather than be ashamed of?
Invite them to find another country. And I am dead serious. Callers to my show from other countries call me almost in tears saying how much Americans don't appreciate what we have. So first, remind them of the founders and their vision for America. And if they disagree with vision for America, leave. I'm dead serious about that. I'm tired of people bashing success. Success is a good thing. I'm not mad at you. I'm just passionate about this. They want to bash and demagogue success. They want to prop up government dependency. And if America is so bad and if capitalism is so bad, leave. Michael Moore made his money by using the principles of capitalism and then got the nerve to try and help destroy capitalism. How hypocritical is that? So start with reminding them of what the founder's vision was. It's gotten out of whack because of all of the legislation, the regulation, and the taxation. But people who want to try and demonize success in America and demonize free enterprise, they are simply trying to promote a socialist agenda. And I was one of the first people who had the guts to say the S word on the radio. That's what they're promoting. So start with the vision of the founders and ask them, have you ever been outside the United States of America? And if the answer is no, that's why they feel that way. Thank you.
Thanks.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Cain, it's a pleasure to talk to you. I was
a huge
Herman Cain supporter in 2012, so I appreciate you coming out to the YAF and talking with us. That's actually a great segue into my question. You talk about regulation. Actually, I'm Rosie Lane. I'm going to be attending Hillsdale College this fall, hence the blue.
All right.
But I'd like to question you on the idea of regulation. How can we as conservatives communicate this idea? I know the founders talked about it in the Northwest Ordinance, that government shouldn't be interfering between private contracts with individuals
right.
and corporations.
Right.
So what is the best way we can articulate that to our peers, especially as young Americans, mm-hmm. in such a way as to prove to them that free market capitalism through protection of property rights is the best way of actualizing wealth for the masses? Thank you.
Great question. Fortunately, this week, two congressmen, and I can't remember the bill number, introduced legislation. Now, it's got a long way to go. They introduced legislation that would require that an economic analysis be done on any new regulations before it becomes a rule enforced by the federal government. That would be a huge step forward, because right now they're just running wild. There are no, you know, they don't do the analysis. They don't know what the facts are. But in talking with people, try to come up with an example that impacts them. For example, this may not be regulations, but ask them, do they have a job? If they say yes, ask them to pull out their pay stub and walk them through who FICA is. When my son was working in a Godfather's Pizza restaurant and he had his first full-time job at age 16 and he got his first paycheck and he was all excited about it, he said, "Dad, I got my first paycheck." I said, "Great." He said, "Who is this FICA guy?" FICA is your partner called the government. That's Social Security, Medicare. Look that up, folks, and understand. If you get them to look at their paycheck and see how much is being taken out that they have no control over, part of it is regulations and part of it is taxation. Yes, take sir. It home by getting them to look at their pay stub.
Thank you.
You got it. Yes, sir.
Hello, Mr. Cain. My name is Victor Slash. I'm a student at Penn State Law. I think you missed an action that's really damaging the country, and that's segregation. By that, I mean whenever someone disagrees or attacks a policy, they're a racist, they're a bigot, they're homophobic, they're sexist. Instead of discussing issues and working together, we've seen what we can do together. We've repealed every great threat the world has seen since
right.
our existence. So this need to demonize and compartmentalize and remove people from working together. Can you speak to that a little bit?
You're absolutely right. Segregation, intimidation. Because liberals can't argue a position based upon facts and logic, they use intimidation, or in some instances, they want to deny people information so they can make their own decisions and connect the dots for themselves. But that's a great point. They do want to demonize people who disagree with them. Let's use Dr. Ben Carson as an example. He's a friend of mine. Ben knows that I talk about him. Ben Carson was revered and admired by a whole lot of people until he openly criticized Obamacare. And then he was put on somebody's blacklist. No pun intended. See, you all have a sense of humor. Thank you. There are some people who don't know the value of laughing every once in a while. It is a good thing. but you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. They don't have a factual argument. They don't have a logical argument. And with you studying law, you understand logic because that's what you're being trained to be able to do in a courtroom. So those are just, you just have to be aware that the intimidation is taking place. We had posted on our website last week, I don't know if it's still up, but it was a video of two conservative blacks who went to an NAACP conference in Las Vegas, set up a booth for the organization that they represented called Freedom Works, and were harassed like they had just, you know, talked about their mama, because this lady actually said, "You shouldn't even be here." They didn't even want somebody, some conservative blacks, to be at a black conference because they want to keep people ignorant of another point of view. And the only way to fight that
And the only way to fight that is not to be afraid to go into the lion's den and not be afraid to take them on. And if you can get them to have a dialogue with you, that's why I say stay informed. Have your facts ready. And you normally don't need but about 5 or 6, and you're going to win the argument every time. Thanks a lot, my friend. Yep. Yes.
Hello, sir. My name is Rolanda Moretti, and I'm an intern here at YAF, and I'm here to ask you a question from our free Enterprise 101 online audience. So this question's from Michael Pangburn from Lanthrop High School in California. And the question is, how can we explain it to young Americans that, one, the minimum wage works against them, and two, unrestricted immigration is a negative factor in the job market, especially for young people?
The minimum wage one starts with having a series of facts to refute that when they want to make the argument that everybody requires a living wage. Says who? Who made that statement? The founders didn't say anything about a living wage. I always remind people that, and this is their favorite argument, but nobody can live off of minimum wage. When I was running Godfather's Pizza, I had a reporter ask me, so what is a family supposed to do living off of minimum wage if that's all they got? I said, don't try to live off minimum wage. I then say, do what my father did. He worked 3 minimum wage jobs until he could live off 2, until he could live off 1. No whining in America. So have some realistic evidence. Let me give you another fact. In other words, develop 3 facts that you can throw right at them relative to the minimum wage. And you can find this in articles. You read some articles about it. Some articles talk about the next. Just pick 3 facts. Here's one relative to the latest push to increase the minimum wage. When President Obama wanted to mandate a $10.10 minimum wage on all governmental, with all government contracts, he had every right to do that. Within weeks, McDonald's and Burger King and several other quick service restaurant chains that are on the bases announced that they were going to close because they were going to have to comply with the mandate by the president. Here's the unintended consequences that they didn't think about because they thought this was so great. One, what about the families of military people who are working those jobs because their kids are trying to go to school just like everybody else? What about the spouses of people that are working to defend this country who's working there because they needed a second job or wanted a second job because they're trying to save for the future? All of these unintended consequences. So thousands and thousands of jobs are going to be lost. That is a fact. So look up a few facts relative to that. Relative to the second one with respect to, what was the phrase you used about immigration? Unrestricted immigration. I would remind them that we were founded as a nation of laws. We are still a nation of laws. And as long as we are a nation and we want to be the greatest country in the world, we're going to have to adhere to the laws. That's what helped to make America great. Laws. Now, if they want to change the laws, there is a process to do it. Use that process, but let's enforce the laws that we have. Let's start there because that helped build this great country.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. That's Pat, okay? Well, allow me to give a couple of closing comments. First of all, thank you for being here because that means that you do want to be better informed, and that does mean that you are involved, and it does mean that you still believe in this country. And you believe in dreams, and you believe in your dreams. Remember what I suggested to you. Have a dream, or you won't know you got there. And it might change along the way, but that's okay. And then secondly, be a part of the solution.
and have fixed things that you don't believe that are right. And remember, you're not going to be able to change them quickly. You're not going to be able to change them overnight. Some of you may run for public office one day. That's good. There are a lot of ways that people can help change things without running for public office. It's not for everybody. Trust me, I know. It's not for everybody. But whatever it is, whatever your talents and skills and abilities are, figure out how you can best use them to help fight the attacks on the American dream. Dr. Mays, who I've referred to, also used to remind the men of Morehouse about something else, about how short life is, and make the most of it. Right now, you're probably not thinking about being 30, 40, 50, 60 years old if you live that long. But if God is good to you, you might. But your life can be wiped out in an instant. You're looking at somebody that when I turned 60 years old, 61 years old, I discovered and was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. I had cancer in my colon and cancer in my liver. I had to go through chemotherapy. They then removed 30% of my colon. That's your gut. They removed 70% of my liver. The liver is the only organ in the body that will rejuvenate itself and grow back to its full size. But when the doctor first told me he was going to take out 70% of my liver, I said, "Doc, I'm only going to have a sliver of liver left. Can you live off a sliver of liver?" He said, "Yes." And I'm proud and thankful to be able to tell you that that was 8 years ago. So I do believe in God Almighty, and I'm proud to say so. And I don't know if you saw the recent appeals court ruling that told the atheist to take a hike about that cross at Ground Zero made up of those beams. So Dr. Mays used to remind us, life is just a minute, only 60 seconds in it. Forced upon you, can't refuse it. Didn't seek it, didn't choose it. But it's up to you to use it. You must suffer if you lose it. Give an account if you abuse it. Just a tiny little minute. But your dreams and your eternity is in that minute. Thank you very much.